Nuclear industry whistleblowers. That next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Our subject, nuclear industry whistleblowers, Paul Blanche and Dave Lockbaum. Paul, you were quoted, in fact, you wrote it in a column in the Day of New London, Connecticut in 1992. It appears to me that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, with its present leadership, is not unlike a colony of parasites more concerned about their own survival and the survival of their host, the nuclear industry, than in the protection of the general public. Is that still the situation?
That is exactly the situation. The entire industry feeds on itself. There are approximately 200,000 people who depend on the nuclear industry for their livelihood. And if that industry dies, they lose their livelihood. In today's job market, there's not much to go to. And there's only one way to keep that industry alive, and that's to keep the industry economically competitive with other forms of producing electrical power. Right now, the competitive nature is certainly in question, and it's an absolute necessity to keep nuclear power competitive. Now, the way to keep it competitive is obviously not to impose additional costs on the utilities, major costs. But yet, they still must. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission, must continue to provide the illusion that they're doing the proper job without impacting the economics of nuclear power. And the way they appear to do it is they take very severe enforcement on small issues that are insignificant, that have high visibility. But when it comes to major issues, such as the issues that I identified or the issues that Dave Lockbaum next to me identified, they seem to sweep them under the table, because if they did enforce their regulations, the economic impact of the backfits or the modifications required to address those safety concerns would be so significant such that it would make nuclear power non-competitive, and it would essentially cause the nuclear industry to continue in its spiral downward and cause many of the plants to shut down because they are not economically competitive.
Now, you're a nuclear engineer, Paul. You're a believer in nuclear power. Does it hurt you to have to say the administration of nuclear power in the United States stinks?
It hurts me very much because I have been in the nuclear industry approximately 29 years. I used to operate nuclear power plants on submarines in the United States Navy. I used to go out on speaking tours promoting nuclear power. I always believed that nuclear power is safe. Over the last 4 years, in dealing with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission at the highest levels, dealing with some of the Senate subcommittees, I'm finding that we don't know how safe nuclear power is, because there are so many major regulations that are being ignored, and a safety assessment is never being done as far as what type of impact does ignoring this particular regulation have on the overall risk to the general public. Dave's issue is one that is major, probably the biggest issue that has been identified in the last 10 years. But all of these issues, hundreds and hundreds of issues, significantly increase the risk. And we don't know what the risk of nuclear power is. Right here in Cambridge, Mass., Dr. Rasmussen of MIT did a study in the mid-70s. And he said that the risk was acceptable. It was acceptable to me. The probability of an accident was very, very remote. Maybe one in a million years, one in a thousand years, probably okay. But his assumptions are no longer valid, because his assumptions assume that the regulations were being followed as written by Congress. They're no longer being followed. They're being ignored. We, as members of the public, no longer know what the risk is. The people that live in the vicinity of these plants has no idea. The NRC has no idea what the risk is anymore. And we have the right to know. When I get in a car, I elect to take that risk. I know what the risk is, that there is, I have 1 in 100,000 chance of getting killed. When I get in an airplane, I know that 1 out of 10 million planes is going to crash. I voluntarily elect to take that risk of going on an airplane. With a nuclear power plant, I don't voluntarily take that risk. That plant could be built in my backyard or in my state where I have no say. And we don't have a Congress that is listening to us very much. And certainly we don't have a Nuclear Regulatory Commission that cares about anything other than their own survival.
Wow. Dave Lockbaum, you too, you're a nuclear engineer. You're a believer in nuclear energy.
Yes.
Does it hurt you to have to become a whistleblower in this field?
Yeah, I never thought that I would. After 15 years, I'd heard about other whistleblowers, but I never imagined that I myself would be in it. In that role, but in fact, when I went to the NRC with this issue 18 months ago, I assumed that would be the end of my involvement. I likened it to calling in the cavalry. You know, they would see the issue, take and make sure that everything that needed to be done would be done. And it was quite disappointing to find out that that's not the case. And very little was done.
Very little was done, and it's a hell of an issue. I mean, Paul talks about it being the most important issue in the last 10 years, and involves spent fuel pools,
right?
And maybe explain it. The average viewer perhaps is not too up on the fancy technical terms, but if you can explain it, I think it would be important.
I could try. The concern we identified was in a boiling water reactor design, where following a major accident, the cooling system for the spent fuel pool and the radiated fuel that's maintained there is intentionally disabled. That allows the water in the fuel pool to heat up and eventually boil. And the consequences from the boiling water and the heat and the temperature and the humidity effects from that situation haven't been considered in the design of the plant.
Let me put it in my own words. I've written a couple of books about nuclear power. I think I could help explain it too.
Okay.
The spent fuel from a plant, those uranium fuel rods, and this is after they've become irradiated by fission.
Right.
Are put in kind of like swimming pools next to nuclear power plants. Mm-hmm. And on the top of these huge pools are often it's just corrugated steel. It's they don't have containments. And they're kept in these pools because there's no place to put high-level nuclear waste in the U.S. Nobody has figured out really what to do with it.
Right.
And the water is to keep circulating, because if it doesn't keep circulating, those uranium cores, they just can go crazy and you can have an enormous accident. If a nuclear plant accident happens and there's no electricity, no power to keep that water in circulation moving, you could have what's called a loss of water accident. You could have all the nuclear poisons in one of those swimming pools, and again, they're around any nuclear plant in the U.S., no containment above, just erupt with all the toxic plutonium and so forth, and the other fission products in those rods just going haywire. That's the issue. You try to blow the whistle about it, what happened?
Well, for the first 10 months, the NRC did very little with the concerns. We were very disappointed or disenchanted with their inaction, so we contacted the three congressional committees that oversee the NRC, and when these congressional committees started asking some questions, the NRC went into a little bit faster pace. I guess it would have been easy going from nothing to a little bit faster pace, but so that was about 6 months ago, and to date, they still have taken no action generically, because there's approximately 35 plants in this country that are similar design, and they've not required any of these plants to address this issue and correct the problem.
Dave, why? I mean, it's their soup, too. Some of these people, you know, inspectors have nuclear plants 50, 30, 20 miles down their roads, too. I mean, why aren't, we're just talking about a life and death, we're talking about a life and death issue.
For some people, I think It's a combination of factors. I think it's complacency. We haven't had a major accident in this country since Three Mile Island. People think it's not going to happen again. I think it's a lot of it's industry pressure. This is going to be an expensive problem to fix. The NRC hears a lot from the industry that they're driving the costs up with all the regulations, and they're driving utilities out of business. So there's great reluctance to impose any new requirements on a utility. And unless there's somebody, either Congress or the news media or somebody, drawing enough attention to these problems, there's no incentive for the NRC to take that action.
We'll be back with nuclear industry whistleblowers right after this.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe. Trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen. Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
I dreamed all of the animals will be safe forever.
I dreamed our water got clean again.
I would like more trees to grow.
And the ozone layer will get strong again.
Fish are neat, and I don't want any of them to die.
I dreamed our Earth will get well again, because everyone who lived here started doing things to help it.
Help our planet to get better.
Earth Day is April 22nd.
Since 1974, Plenty International has been a valuable tool for people who want to lend a hand, but in ways that are effective, respectful, and appropriate. Much needs to be done, like installing running water for Mayan villages in the highlands of Guatemala, helping Native Americans develop home gardens, and working for the improved nutrition of children in Nicaragua. Plenty fields volunteers from all walks of life, recognizes the interdependence of all living things, and works to promote economic fair play, cultural diversity, and a livable environment. If we put our minds, hearts, and hands together, we can do what needs to be done. For more information, please write Plenty, P.O. Box 2306, Davis, California, 95617, or call 916-753-0731.
We're back with two courageous nuclear industry whistleblowers. Paul Blanche, Dave, was talking about these loss of water accidents. It would be even worse, a loss of water accident than, I mean, it's comparing, I suppose, diphtheria and typhoid, but it would be even worse in certain respects to a singular nuclear plant accident, wouldn't it?
Well, I don't want to speak for Dave, but Chernobyl had one core in it, about the same size as the average power plant here in the United States, about 1,000 megawatts. When you're talking about a spent fuel pool, because the federal government hasn't developed any disposal for the high-level waste, it's being all stored on these various sites. And in a spent fuel pool, depending how old the plant is, you may have as many as 10 spent cores of reactor fuel. Now, we know what the consequences were at Chernobyl, where they had to permanently evacuate for a radius of about 30 miles. You take a plant like Pilgrim, just south of Boston, Massachusetts here, and evacuate 30 miles, 40 miles around that, and consider what happens to cities like Boston, Providence, Cape Cod. The consequences are phenomenal with this spent fuel pool event.
Yeah, and as we've said, there's really no protection. I mean, they claim the nuclear industry, at least those domes over the plants themselves, will not hold in much. I mean, they're only able to withstand about 50, 60 pounds per square inch pressure. They can't withstand a steam explosion. But one of these fuel pools, I mean, they're all but out there, you know? It's
Well, if we go back to that and we look back to the development of nuclear power in this country, in the 1970s, it was expected that they would never have more than one or two cores in there because the government was going to take away the high-level waste. These spent fuel pools were never designed to hold what they're holding right now because there's no place to put this spent uranium.
Let's talk again about the people who are supposed to be protecting us in terms of nuclear power. Let's go to the industry, if we could. Now, Paul, you've worked in the industry. You started in the nuclear Navy, which is a very common kind of path, and then you went to the nuclear industry. You worked for Northeast Utilities, which is I'd say one of the biggest nuclear utilities in the United States at this point, with the three Millstone nuclear plants, and it's a part owner of the Seabrook nuclear plant and so forth. The mentality of the business people who the utility people who run nuclear plants, is that different than the NRC mentality?
Well, I think, again, it's all gets back to the survival. Everyone needs the security of having their job. If you're in big business and you're in management, it doesn't matter what utility, their bottom line is what they're going to make for profit. And in order to make more profit, they have to cut costs. Right now, all utilities are cutting back to keep nuclear power economically competitive. They're cutting back on manpower. They're cutting back on design modifications. They're minimizing costs and increasing risk in just about everything they do. It's going to have to continue. I think one way we could make nuclear power safe is if we jacked up the price of oil to about $200 a barrel. If it were $200 a barrel, we could afford to spend the money that's required to make nuclear power safe again. At $200 a barrel, nuclear power could be competitive if you even double the capital cost of the present system.
And if you didn't have solar, if you didn't have wind, you didn't have the other alternatives, you know, maybe if you put a lot of money in. But the utility executives, don't they realize? I mean, I'm a utility executive and I live near Seabrook, just north of Boston, 10, 12 miles, I believe, north of Boston, or 15, something like that, north of Boston. Aren't I concerned about something happening at Seabrook?
Well, I think everyone's concerned. I mean, look at the big controversy we have with smoking right now. Everyone knows that smoking's harmful, but we continue it. Why do we continue it? As far as the tobacco companies, it's bottom line profits. I mean, that's what the utility executives are doing, bottom line profits. It doesn't matter what the risk is. They're potentially going to kill thousands of people, but it doesn't matter. They're playing the probability game, hoping it won't occur while they're in that position. And if they do, they'll always find someone to blame. I mean, you talk about the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. When that, I don't say if, but I say when that next accident occurs, they're going to blame that on the utility. Just like they did Three Mile Island, everything else that occurs is blamed on the utility. And it's never blamed on the equipment or the design. They'll always find an operator who was asleep or an operator who violated procedures. So no one except that poor operator takes the blame. According to the NRC, there's nothing wrong with nuclear power. It was the operator that really screwed up on this one.
Human error. Dave, you worked most recently at, what was it, Susquehanna, the utility you worked for?
Well, Pennsylvania Power and Light was the utility.
And you worked at their Susquehanna?
I worked in their central office for Susquehanna, yes.
For the Susquehanna nuclear plant.
Right.
When you've had, and you've worked for different utility executives than Paul has, when you've encountered them on these safety issues, what's been the attitude you've found?
I think the attitude you find is similar to the attitude you found in the NRC. I don't think it's a conscious decision to ignore nuclear safety. I think what instead the system has a bias built into it such that when an issue is raised, the incentive on everybody's part is to make it go away. And so the process doesn't become a search for the truth, whether the issue is valid or not, is a search until you find something that will make the issue go away. You may find something that superficially appears to make the issue go away, and you stop looking at that point. Where instead, when you look beyond that and look at the truth and what really is involved, you find a problem, and there's no incentive for everybody to go through the longer path.
Truth could be quite a problem. We'll be back with nuclear industry whistleblowers right after this.
It's coming. The most significant event in automotive history. It's coming. The end of the age of the automobile.
Skies are blue and clouds are white. The bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
If you're not recycling, you're throwing it all away. Don't worry, the safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
Paul, Dave talks about bias. Could you elaborate on that? Have you encountered it?
When I was in the nuclear Navy, we were always taught, and I believed it, that these plants were so over-designed that the metal was 10 times thicker than it had to be, that we had multiple redundant systems, defense in depth, that if one system failed, another system would take over and perform the function of that. And again, we've always had this bias, not only in the nuclear Navy, but also in the civilian nuclear power program, where I've been working for 21 years. So there's an inherent bias that nothing will ever go wrong, and therefore it's okay to let little things slip by. And I think that the general attitude of the people working in the industry, utilities, vendors such as your General Electric's, Westinghouse, and so on, and the NRC fully believe that no matter what happens, nothing really is going to happen as far as endangering the public. But I've uncovered two issues that certainly challenge the defense in depth: the common mode failure of the devices that measure flows, levels, and pressures in the reactor. They could all fail at the same time. On the General Electric reactors, I found where every water level instrument not probably will fail in the event of an accident, but definitely will fail. All redundant systems will fail in the event of an accident. When I brought this to the NRC, I got a very similar treatment that David got. They didn't want to hear about it. General Electric didn't want to hear about it. They said it wasn't a problem. They denied it. They tried to retaliate against me, to suppress me, and so on and so forth. And that includes the Nuclear Regulatory Commission tried to suppress me. They don't want to hear this information.
Let me grab onto that if I can. Suppress you, quiet you. How did they do it?
Well, when I identified this major issue, I was responsible for implementing the repair at the utility I was working for, which was Northeast Utilities. And when we were doing the repair, of course, we had a dozen NRC people overlooking everything that I did. They were watching me. They found that I was 3 days late on obtaining a signature on a purchase order. They issued a violation to Northeast Utilities and made a statement to the press that Blanche violated commission regulations. These are the type of enforcement action we get. They don't worry about the big potential accident. They worry about, I forgot to dot an I or cross a T, and that actually encouraged, and I believe that my departure from the industry was encouraged by the highest levels of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, because I was a big thorn in their side. I embarrassed the Nuclear Regulatory Commission for their total incompetence.
And the NRC attempting to smear whistleblowers is so common. I mean, there's been a big issue made in recent weeks of people going to the NRC anonymously, would-be whistleblowers, and suddenly the NRC divulging the names, the identities of the whistleblowers to the utility, and they end up getting in trouble. I mean, wow.
Well, that has a far-reaching effect in that many people have come to me after my issue went to the NRC with concerns of their own, and they are very reluctant to go to the NRC because of the way the NRC's handled other individuals like Paul, myself, and others. So that the NRC's actions have led to other issues being suppressed, and I don't think the NRC or the industry is too concerned about that.
And we're all in danger as a result. We'll be back right after this with Enviro Close-Up. the Atomic Energy Commission was abolished in the mid-70s because it was seen they didn't regulate the nuclear industry, and they created, the government did, a Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Do you think it's time to abolish the NRC too?
No, I think in concept the NRC can do a good job. The problem is it's the people who are running the commission. Congressional staffer told me last Wednesday that since 1980 there have been 14 people appointed to the commission by the president. Of these 14 people, every one of them have had the total 100% endorsement of the industry. Not one of them has been opposed by the industry. They are not representing the interest of the general public, which is their charter. They are clearly representing the industry. When they leave the commission, they move to your big law firms, to your big utilities, on the board of directors, presidents, and so on and so forth. It's a revolving door where they go from NRC to big business to the law firms. Jim Curtis is working for the biggest nuclear law firm in Washington right now.
A former NRC commissioner. You have faith in the structure of the NRC, Dave?
I think so. I think the structure is okay. It's just that the rules need to be enforced, or the rules need to be changed. You can't ignore the rules and have safe nuclear power in this country.
But the laws in this country so favor atomic power, you know, I mean, the Atomic Energy Act that the NRC works under says that we're supposed to promote nuclear power, and the NRC, even though technically it's not supposed to promote, ends up promoting.
That's true, but as long as we meet the standards we've set, then safe nuclear power can be achieved. But that's not what's happening in our cases, and the consequences of that are pretty severe.
Pretty severe indeed. You've been watching Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Thank you.